Hello, this is Derek Hansen for strengthpowerspeed.com, and this is our ninth episode of our Performance Concepts Chat series. And this episode is essentially a continuation of our discussion with Paul Cheng, the Typhoon, and going into more great stories about his life, his sporting career, and if you're a fan of boxing, mixed martial arts, professional wrestling, if you want to hear some of his stories about his film career, and somehow they all get intertwined together, and there's even some more football. So if you liked part one of our discussion with Paul Cheng, you're just absolutely going to love part two. And again, just full of great stories, and it makes you wonder, what's he going to do with the rest of his career? So please enjoy part two with Paul the Typhoon Cheng. So Paul, after the whole Calgary bobsleigh, Stu Hart wrestling thing, and football is not necessarily in your sights. You know, you had some stuff with Arena, a tryout, and all that. Tell me what happened next. I know I was involved with you for a while there, helping you train, and then slowly but surely you got involved in boxing. Tell me how that happened.
Yeah. So I think after bobsled, I ended up going to. I was supposed to play Arena 2, but it didn't work out. I got into some trouble. So yeah, again, don't get into trouble. And then that whole thing kind of led me. I was a little depressed because I was like, oh, I thought I was gonna revive my football career. That didn't happen.
Yeah.
And then. And then I started going to, I moved next door to, my coach now, I moved next door, like down the block, and okay. I met this guy named Sal, and then he was an MMA fighter, so he used to take boxing lessons or privates with the Tony Pep, and another boxing coach by the name of Rob Della Penna, and who was, I don't know. Kind of known a little bit at the time in whatever else, but he was a good professional boxer. And then we were training with him. Actually he was. And then I ended up...
And this is just something that you thought, hey, I might as well do this.
Yeah, and then he was an MMA fighter. So my buddy, he was an MMA fighter. I used to go to his fights, and then I used to see this stuff. So I was like, maybe I can try.
Sure.
And but I walked into some gyms, a few gyms, but you know, you're a big tough guy. Supposedly I'm a big football player. But it's hard on the ego when you're like, you walk into some brand new thing,
yep,
getting beat up.
Yep.
Literally, I was like, I still remember first few times in boxing, I almost got my head kicked in.
Yep.
And I was like, what is this? And it was like, it was pretty crazy. You know, I think I got proficient at football. You know, things were not going good. And then I was just like, I got into this boxing thing. My friend was doing it, and then I just got into it. So, and then it was something, you know, my knees kind of hurt, but again, it seemed like a lot of football players, a lot of big linemen and stuff, the natural transition to be a heavyweight boxer, because you stand pretty upright,
mm-hmm,
and you don't really change levels too much, you know, like not bending too much. So it's, the training was pretty easy. Not easy. The training was really hard, but it was like easy on my body.
Sure, sure.
It was easy on my body because, you know,
nobody's trying to chop block you or
No. And then we're not moving at 100 million miles an hour.
Yeah.
You know, and it's like I had to last a long time. I had to change my whole entire training system.
Just in terms of the endurance requirement?
And then trying to lose weight because I was like 280, 90 pounds.
Mm-hmm.
But now it's like carrying all this extra weight, I get tired so fast. And I was like, instead of going 20 seconds, I had to go 3 minutes.
Yeah.
So I had to figure out how to do this thing in 3 minutes.
Yeah.
So, and then I got into a couple of amateur boxing fights. Didn't do too good. The one time my eye swelled up, I lost by TKO, but I almost had the guy knocked out. And then the second time was, I was a sparring, exhibition sparring match with my friend. He was a professional boxer. And then I did okay. And then... Again, I just wanted to dive to the deep end. So I was like, so I decided, I was like, so maybe you want to So, yeah. So I took a professional boxing fight at the casino.
Okay.
So I started training, and then, and then I got into this boxing. So I had, I think, a total of 4 boxing fights, and I won my first 3 boxing fights. And trust me, I wasn't good at boxing at the time. It was just, apparently I figured out I hit a guy with my right hand, and they go down. And I was like, really? That was it? But realistically, I was far from, you know, like this is looking back like what, 7-8 years, 2009, I think.
Yeah.
So I'm just kind of like all that time, 8 years ago, I'm very, very beyond whatever, but I wasn't a pro boxer, but it was just more like, hey, I was a freak sideshow, knocked people out. And then, you know, I fought a real fighter, you know, a guy that actually had a pulse. And then, you know, I ran into some punches that shouldn't happen. I got knocked out. First time in my life. And then, again, another lesson I had to learn in my life.
And that's what anybody who's told me who's been in the fight game is like, it's one thing to try to punch somebody, but you have to be able to take a shot. And what was it like when you first somebody really solidly rocked you? What was that compared to like your football?
It was a really weird day that day, to be honest. I'm going to tell background, another bad story, background story. I have lots of these. So, so I wear glasses, as you can see. And then my prescription is about 4.0 and then like 4.25, something like that. So I'm not like, it's blurry when I have my glasses off.
Mm-hmm.
So the commission that day kind of told me I couldn't wear my contact lenses. And I usually fight in them.
Okay.
Yeah. And, you know, usually it's a soft one. So even if my eye swells up, whatever, they usually fall out. So it's not that big of a deal.
Mm-hmm.
But I still remember that day they made me take them out because I don't know for what reason. So I fucked. And then again, this is another lesson to fighting blind. I did that one another time too. So, I got knocked out. It was like, you know, my usual fight. So I rocked the guy right off the jump, and then I was going to go in for the finish. Didn't judge my distance right. Didn't see the distance. He stuck a 1-2 out. Bang. Dropped on my face. Instead of me knocking him out in 45 seconds, I got knocked out in 45 seconds. So, and my first 3 professional boxing fights lasted a total of 2 minutes.
Okay.
And 30 seconds in 3 fights. So, this was another hard lesson to learn. Because just think about this. You've been going in and literally knocking people out within a minute and then multiple times. So you just feel like, you know, you're indestructible.
You expect it now.
You expect it. And then I actually had a call. You know, there was like a bigger fight for me. But people wanted me at 4-0. The Chinese heavyweight does 4-0 with 4 knockouts instead of I got knocked out. So I lost my big fight opportunity.
Okay.
But again... And then I saw some things, you know, difference between good coach, bad coach, and, you know, like, and then just staying in hospital all night and dealing with stuff on my own and, you know, and then you just learn certain things. So I decided that this sport wasn't for me. So I decided not to go with the boxing anymore.
Okay.
I think it was the loss. No, you know, like, obviously, you know, it was something affected me, and I just realized I wasn't going to make it to a top level. Because I'm not, it's a sport, I realized you need more skill. And I don't have that kind of time. So I decided I needed to move on from this sport. And then my coach Sal decided that, I forgot to mention, I wrestled for a season at SFU
mm-hmm.
while I was playing college football. And I wrestled since I was a little kid.
Yeah.
So I have not a great wrestling background, but a little one.
But you have one.
I have one.
Yeah.
So I ended up, my coach Sal decided that he's like, hey, now as a boxer, after 4 pro fights, after about 6 fights, I'm survivable now. So I'm okay. I can do it. So my coach Sal decided that he was like, hey, why don't you train MMA with me? So, and then he's like, I'll teach you. So I was like, and at the time, this is the time I ended up getting my first gig as a stuntman. So I worked on I got a movie role, as the Hun in one of the first Night of the Museum movie.
With Ben Stiller. Ben Stiller, like who else was
Robin
in that?
Robin Williams. Yeah, it was like lots of
Owen Wilson.
Wilson, just like, I was like, And then I have another story. You know how I got the audition for that movie?
How'd you get the audition for that movie?
I was sitting eating at Cactus Club with my friends. I met my friend Daryl Kwan at auditions. I just started doing this thing. And then I guess the whole thing was they wanted a bigger Asian guy than him. So he was about 6'2", about 260 pounds, 270 pounds. I'm just about an inch taller and just about 10 pounds bigger. So Daryl walks in the restaurant. He's like, I've been looking for you. I was like, really? For what? So yeah, this is the story of my life. I swear, you can ask people. It's actually happened. I'm not talking garbage.
You're falling ass backwards into new opportunities.
Yes, yeah. ass backwards, as usual. So my friend Daryl walks into Cactus Club in Burnaby there. I'll remember it for the rest of my life. He's like, hey, what are you doing right now? I was like, I'm meeting with my friends. And then at the time, I was doing all right financially, so I wasn't worried about whatever. But he's like, hey, you should come with me right now. I was like, to do what? He's like, audition. I was like, audition for what? Just come with me. And I was like, okay. So I went. So I decided, I left middle of dinner.
Great.
And and it was like literally right across the street, Bridge Studios.
Yep.
Right across the street. So I literally, from the restaurant, went right across the street, walked into this room, and there was like the big, huge native guys, a couple other big, kind of Asian-looking guys. And then I saw the director walk out, and he just pointed at me. And he was him. And then walks out. And then all of a sudden, he was like, and I walk out, and I see Daryl, and he's like, you got it, right? And I was like, I don't know. And then he's just like, he told me, he's like, I'm pretty sure you got it. So like literally the next day, I was getting my face casted, my body casted, just all kinds of stuff, crazy stuff was going on. I was like, what is going on here? Until I figured out, Night Museum was like a big $100 million movie or crazy stuff like that. And then I was.
And they actually made a statue of you that was.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. There's like a statue of me, that's been circulating around museums all around the world. Apparently, it's apparently in the LA History Museum, the London Museum.
And awesome.
I was just like, this is apparently a true story. I have a picture of this. I have a picture of this statue.
And then the great thing about that whole experience too is you got to meet some of these guys and hang out on set with them.
Yeah, and then I got to do three movies with them.
Yeah,
you know, I know Derek, you're a personal trainer for some of the stars too, and then you know you kind of get the idea of this whole situation. They're really nice people, most of them really cool people.
Yeah, yeah.
They're just like me and you. So it was like, yeah, and then how that correlated, because I ended up with Daryl was an Asian stuntman. And then all the guys I worked with were Asian stuntmen. So they told me, hey, if you want to be a stuntman, you should learn martial arts. So that's what driven me to learn martial arts.
Okay.
So that's one of the reasons why. Okay. So I ended up talking to my friend Sal, because he was really good at Muay Thai kickboxing. Really good. And then he lived in Thailand for a while and trained MMA. So I decided, so I asked him to train me. And then, so basically, that's what we did. And then after a while, I was like, this fake fighting thing is not that fun. Because I haven't been competitive for a while, maybe 4 or 5 years.
Yeah.
And then, since my boxing. Yeah, so I wasn't competitive for a couple of years. So my first fight was 2011. So I haven't been competitive for a couple of years.
Sure.
So I decided, and then he's like, well, let's book you an MMA fight.
Like that.
So with no amateur experience, as usual, I got myself into a professional mixed martial arts fight. And then just like that.
You're acting with no experience. You're fighting in a cage with no experience.
Yeah, so apparently I can box a little bit. So but look at this. I wrestled in college. I wrestled in high school and college, and I had a little bit of a boxing background now. So my coach Sal put me together about 3 months. We trained about 3 months, and then I got a professional mixed martial arts fight on the island in Victoria. And surprisingly, I won. So yeah, and then not because of my boxing ability, not because of anything else, and it's because I had a great double leg, and I did a double. I took the guy down 6 times.
Wow.
I think. Okay. In 3 rounds. And I never been so tired in my life. You ever been 15 minutes? Well, fighting a guy for 15 minutes? I have. Not the most fun. But it was something. It was an interesting experience. And I made $500 to show and $500 to win. So I made $1,000. Wow. That was a gigantic check. But again, I really do appreciate, I think it was Aggression Fighting Championships for giving me the opportunity to, you know, sometimes, you know, you just want to test yourself a little bit. It was kind of cool.
But after that, I mean, did you sit down with the coach and say, and did he say like, okay, I think we got something here?
Yes. And then after we were like, hey, maybe we should try again. And I was like, you know what? That was really cool. So I was like, yeah, let's do it. And then I'm riding high as usual. Yeah, I just beat this guy. And oh, yeah, I'm coming off my losing. Yeah, now I just avenged for that loss. Oh, I'm feeling great. Then I decide to fight this guy that's like, his name was Peter Nolan, another lesson in my life. I think he was the bus driver or something like that.
That was his nickname? Yeah, the bus driver?
Yeah, something like that. Awesome. And then, but he was a high level jiu-jitsu guy.
Okay.
And a wrestling guy, like a high level wrestler and a high level jiu-jitsu guy. Like, I think he won some world tournament I didn't know this, but he was one of the better grapplers in Canada.
Okay.
So I was like, okay.
He's legit.
Yeah, he was legit. Legit grappler and then good record, like undefeated record, but he was like 205 pounds. So I go to this fight thinking, I'm just going to beat this guy up. Boy, was I wrong. Oh, well, if you see my face and you see, which eye was I gushing out of? I think it was this one. I think I have 7 stitches. So I've never really felt.
So he drove the bus over you.
Oh yeah, way worse than that. I'm just like, I've been a pretty good athlete up to this point. And then I don't think I've ever, Peter, I appreciate, if you ever listen to this, I appreciate the lesson. I really do appreciate it. And I'm like, I thought at the beginning of the fight, I was going to kill this guy. He weighed like 216 pounds. I weighed 265 pounds.
Yeah.
I was big. I was in shape. And I didn't think he could take me down. And then again, technique and practice and all this stuff comes into play one more time. So I get taken down and held down, and I couldn't do nothing about it. I've never felt so helpless in my life. I guess this is how maybe I felt almost so helpless to the point that if I was a woman and somebody was trying to take advantage of me and I was trying to get out, but I couldn't. That's how I felt like.
Okay.
It was that bad.
But you didn't, did you ever think of like, okay, I'm just going to tap out? Like,
but I did not want to tap out.
Yeah.
He elbowed me for 5 minutes. I still have the blood stain, the giant blood stain I left on that mat. It was literally squirting out of my face. Ugh, excuse my language. I don't know. It was literally just going poof. Poof. I left a big giant puddle of blood for 5 minutes. And you know what? And
But you made it out.
No.
Well, the bell eventually run.
And he choked me.
Oh, he choked you. Okay.
Yeah. It was a head and arm choke. And then.
To top it all off.
Yeah, it all off. And then I was just like, I took a 4 minute and I think 40 second beating. And then, yeah, he choked me out. Okay. So I got submitted.
Okay.
So then from that day on, I was like, I need to learn jiu-jitsu. I was a 2-stripe white belt at the time. And then we did as much as we could. I don't blame any of my coaches because there was a huge level difference.
Sure.
I think he was like brown belt or black belt level at the time.
Okay.
And I'm like, you know, I was a white belt. I did have some wrestling, but again, this guy was a better wrestler than me. He was just better than me at the time in general.
Okay.
So, and I learned my lesson. once again. So I decided that I need to learn how to do jiu-jitsu. And then I kind of put a lot of focus of my life on jiu-jitsu. Yes. And then it went on. So I lost that fight. It was pretty embarrassing. I felt really down. And I was like, maybe this is it. That's it. That's it. I was like, you know, I had my experience. And then this is not worth it.
Yeah. But.
But. Obviously, they always suck you back in somehow, some way. It's just been the story of my life. I got a fight offer to go fight in Montreal.
Okay.
And then against one of the best heavyweight boxers in Montreal. And he just beat Butterbean.
Oh, okay.
He submitted Butterbean, wow, his last MMA fight. It was for Ringside. So Ringside was like the biggest promotion in Montreal. And it was like George St. Pierre came, you know, like those, like it was like kind of a similar situation to TKO. So a lot of the big stars came out of that. So I got to meet some. And when I went there, you know, some of the, I fought on the same card with I think three UFC guys.
Okay.
Yeah, three UFC guys that's competing in the UFC at this point on the same card.
So it was
a big show.
Okay.
It was a really big show. And then I ended up going to, you know, a big promotion as well. So it was like top to bottom. I was like, wow, just this sports journey has been so crazy. I just got to meet so many people.
Yep.
And then, so yeah. And then I still remember, that fight going away for the first time and then going to somebody else's house. Going to Montreal when it was main event against a guy that once more time should have knocked me out. But you know what?
And he had the home crowd with him.
Yeah, he had the home crowd. He was 10-0 national amateur champion, 10-0 in boxing, something, 8 knockouts. So he was supposed to beat me easy. But I learned jiu-jitsu.
And so, what happened?
Yeah, so during the fight, I threw a flying front kick, flying across the ring, front kick, pushed him to the cage, whipped him down, and he tapped the top pressure. I held him down. He could move, like what happened to me the last time.
Oh, okay.
And I beat him in 1 minute and 50 seconds or something like that, under 2 minutes.
Wow.
And then all of a sudden, things were like looking good for me again. I was like, oh, this sports thing was never going to go away. Then after that fight, I ended up getting a real big fight. I ended up going to Calgary to fight this guy, Ryan the Hitman Hunter. He was like 3-4-0.
Okay.
And then it looked like one of us was going to be going to a big promotion.
Okay.
So I took that fight. I went to fight him, and then he was the big man in town again. So I went into his house, 4,000, 5,000 people. I don't know what the guy did. I don't know, whatever, but I saw various, there was like heavy police presence there.
Oh, okay.
That day.
Okay. So.
And then I still remember walking into the venue. There was a big giant poster of my face facing Ryan and then Mr. Hunter or whatever. And then we decide, and then, yeah. And then the police asked me for my ID, and I didn't have it. I was like, is that okay?
Yeah. I didn't bring my wallet to the ring.
Yeah, I was just checking this out, but is that okay? I'm on the poster. So they're like, hey, you're going to fight this guy? I was like, yeah. And then I guess for the first time ever, my police officers are real nice to me.
Oh, okay. So they're on your side.
They were apparently on my side.
This is a bad dude. We want you to take care of him.
I don't know. I have no idea. He was a nice guy to me, so I could care less.
Sure.
So we were just competing. So it's just like, it is what it is. Obviously, he was going to do the same thing to me. It was an interesting fight, and it ended in a brutal knockout in my favor.
I saw that one, yeah.
Yeah, it was. And again, you know, it's a fight game, but I don't think I've ever been in a stadium where I knocked a guy out, and it was so quiet. And then I was screaming, running around. But again, and I apologize that I should have a little more class, but it was just a little bit exciting. So, yeah, so that was that. And then my friend And then all of a sudden, you know, one of these trips, on my MMA journey, I ended up running out to TriStar.
Yep.
And with an old jiu-jitsu coach of mine, Ahmed, and then we went to TriStar to meet Dennis Kang.
Mm-hmm.
So Dennis Kang was his buddy, and Dennis Kang was like, I was like, wow, Pride fighter and UFC fighter. I was like, oh my God. He was like, you know, a guy that I looked up to. So I got to, and we went to TriStar to go hang out with Dennis. So I paid for the trip, you know, and then it was great. And I went there, got to train with George St. Pierre, and got to train with like Cliff Francis, Caramon, and had a Steve Bosse, a whole bunch of these UFC guys again.
Yeah.
And then, you know what? And then I was then there's pro sparring. And then I was sparring Francis Caramon. And he was in the UFC. He fights at, and then now he's in Bellator. He fights at 205, you know, and then I did good.
So yeah, again, it's this continual theme of you going into something else. You might have some
and then we have
adversity.
And then I learn my adversity, and then it comes through.
Yeah, things work out.
And it was just like, I just want to say it, guys. You know, don't go to the athlete graveyard. You know, I'm 38 years old. I still have a few more stories for you.
Oh yeah,
a lot more actually. But I'm just like, don't quit. You know, don't just go get old and fat and just like run on a couch and that's it. Like, I got some more stories.
Yeah, yeah. So after that, and we might jump to your overseas stuff.
Okay, let's do that. So
you've conquered Western Canada, Montreal. Yeah.
And then I was doing good. I was becoming one of the top five heavyweights in the country because I beat an undefeated prospect. And then all of a sudden, Dennis calls me. And then I talked about him going over, went to find him. So he kind of knows, he knew about me now. And then I'm doing good. And now he's like, so asked me for some information, and then I guess maybe a few hours later, I had like 8 missed phone calls from him. I was like, what the hell? Why is Dennis calling me so many times? I was like, I what's going on? So I guess Matt Hume from One Championship called him, and then they wanted to sign me that day.
Wow.
So I was like, so what's One Championship? And I was like, it's the revival of the giant Asia promotion, like Pride and whatever. But it's not Pride because UFC owns Pride and we're a different entity.
Yep.
But again, it's like, it was the big leagues. And then I was like, you know, after football, after all this stuff, after seeing everything, I was like, you know what? Hey, it's another chance. So let's try.
Sure.
So yeah. And a few months later, I was training and doing all this stuff. And then, you know, getting ready, and then I fought, and then I got the call, and I got to fight a guy by the name of Alan the Black Panther Galani, who was like a K-1 Muay Thai world champion, and I was like, man, why is this gonna get any harder?
he's a bad looking dude, right?
Yeah, like, and then I saw the tapes,
yeah,
and I was like, this guy was a world champion kickboxer, so I started watching all these films. You know, like before football, you got to study your opponent. And then all of a sudden, I'm like, oh my God, I'm in for a world of trouble again. So this guy's like a world-class stand-up guy. So just like knocking people right yep, and left, and then watching K-1 fights, and all these K-1, top-notch K-1 guys are getting beat by him. And I was like, oh. And I look on his Wikipedia page, and I'm like, great, this guy's got a Wikipedia page too. So I'm like, oh well, it is what it is. Let's go. Let's try. So again, hey, when your life tells you to do something, just do it. Just try. You never know what can happen. I think that day I opened up as like a 5 or 6 to 1 underdog. The guy like put 2 ring girls on his arms and did the Van Damme splits. And then it was pretty crazy. And then I was like, oh, pretty athletic dude. You look like He-Man.
Yeah.
So I was like, wow. And then he could do the splits too and flips. I was like, whoa, I might not be in for a good day. But you know what? Hey, never quit. Again, just went into battle, did my thing. And thank you, jiu-jitsu. saved me again. I got taken down. The fight didn't stand up for that long. Got taken down. He was on top, and I survived.
Yeah.
Thank you, jiu-jitsu. And then I turned it around. Stood up, turned it around, and I won the fight. And everyone was shocked.
Including yourself?
Including myself. I was like, man, I just beat like a multiple-time world champion in a fight. This is cool. And I'm like 35. So I was like, hey, I'm doing a good job. And I was just like, and I've noticed as I train more and more, I've had more confidence. My body started looking better and better. And I'm just like, hey, am I supposed to be old? You know, I should be on my decline. But no, it's not. So and then I got to fight again. So I was like, you know what? Let's try this. And I got to fight for my home country in Taiwan.
How was that experience?
Great. My whole life, everybody's ever told me, can't do this, can't do that. And then, oh, you're Chinese, you can't play this, you can't do this. And I'm just like, no. My mom, first time in my life, when they posted the Taiwan card, Taipei. And I was like, are you kidding me? And I was begging them. I was like, you got to put me on this thing. They're like, yes, you're on. And then they flew me back for a press conference, got to go back to my homeland. And I was like, my dream. Have you ever walked out? And I got to that day, even though I had some crazy stuff happen, I wrote an article actually about my dog, that experience that day.
Mm-hmm.
On MMA Sucker. You guys could have a read about exactly what happened, what happened in my mindset. But it was just like, it was the most incredible day for me. But I had a lot of stress. And then I walked out there. I had my whole home country standing up, waving glow sticks. And I was like, really? I got here. Even my mother was like, before the fight, she was like, I was nervous, but I just couldn't believe all these people stood up for my son.
So would you say after all these years of your sports career you have now, family support?
Like, yeah, this family support, because my family came out. I had like, I think I had 100 people there.
Wow.
Like 100 people. Everybody came out. I walked out and I was like, still stressed, but I was just like living my dream.
Sure.
When I was a kid, nobody would, in Taiwan, nobody would have thought I could have done anything. And then that was the first major event in Taiwan, a first major MMA event in Taiwanese history. And
they have one of their own.
And then we had one of their own competing. Yeah. You know, and we had a few guys. There was a couple other guys competing on the card.
Okay,
but this was my second fight, so and I won. So I was on the I was like one of the top. And we all did great that night. I had a rough night, so I broke my orbital, and then stayed 3 days in the hospital. But I won. So just one of those things. Don't quit. Things happen. Just keep going. You know, I won. I had like a lot of rough things and, you know, I got into all kinds of financial trouble because my dog and all that other stuff. But we'll talk. That's read the article. Just like you, if I have other things, I'll refer, watch the podcast. So, yeah. And then that was that. And then I got to accomplish one of my dreams. Like my mother came to my fight.
That's great.
Just like they came to my first Lions exhibition game because they promised. It's like, when you're on TV, we'll come. And I was like, okay. So my parents came to my... I accomplished a few of my goals. My parents came and watched me play football. And then now, my mother came to watch me fight. And it was pretty good because I won both times.
Yeah.
And that time when they came to watch, I picked up a fumble and then I had Mo Ellen Winnebe from the Winnipeg Blue Bombers and the Washington Redskins, all-line trophy winners, smacked me and just like, congrats, I had a great day. Congrats, you just made the CFL. That was a great day in my life.
Good.
So I was sitting there, you know, I had a lot of interesting moments that like I've never forget. And one of those is one of those moments just watching my mom. And then my mom, I still remember this, sitting by my hospital bed because I broke my orbital pretty bad. And I fought the guy blind almost. So that's the second time I fought blind. And he was, she was just sitting there just like, you know what, son? I was like, what? You're an idiot? But for about 10 minutes of my life, I was really proud of you. but look at your face. Yeah. And I was like, yeah, thanks, Mom. I appreciate it. After all that hard work, after everything I went through, and I was just like, you know what? That felt pretty good. I'm going to be honest. So, yeah. And then I go through a lot of problems. You know, I got injured, had to pull out of a fight, and then my life wasn't going so good because when you're fighting, you know, remember my first fight, it was $500 and I made $1,000. And then, you know, things started getting better and better. You know, when you fight in the big leagues, it's better. But again, all the money you have to pay to train, all the time you have to expend, doesn't, you know, that's why I have so much respect for all MMA fighters, because it's like, man, you don't understand the work these guys put in. And then the amount of money they get paid, it's not what it should be.
For every guy that's making millions of dollars, yeah, there's thousands of guys making
nothing.
Nothing.
You know, it's like the NFL and arena football. So that's what, and then I, for another experience, I actually got to live some of that and I got to play with some of these guys. And it was like, you know, the talent difference is not that much, but the dollars are just crazy. So anyways, yeah. So what's, oh yeah. So I started acting, and then I started kind of, as I was pursuing my MMA career, I was still doing some acting and stunts because they kind of kept me going. So yeah. We did Night at Museum 2, and then all of a sudden, Night at Museum 3.
And did these guys know that you were out fighting on the side too? And
Not really, kind of. You know, we talked about things, you know, like after a while we were talking with like, I think I had a conversation with Ben Stiller one time. We were like talking and just like, oh yeah, I was fighting and stuff now. And they're like, wow, that's kind of crazy. it was cool. And then, I have another funny story. So after all that stuff, you know, my life was falling apart, and then a single again and blah. And then I was just like, I didn't know what was going to go on. So I got signed onto a TV show. I was playing this guy named Albert Lin on a TV show called Second Chance on Fox. So things are great. I got to shoot Night Museum 3, and then, you know, and then I haven't fought over a year. And then I was just like, I don't think this is ever going to come. But while I was shooting the movie, no, I was shooting the TV show, shot the first episode. I was excited because I was like, hey, this is pretty cool. I get to fight the main character and I'm like the main bad guy. So I was like, oh, this is neat. And then the main cast was really cool. They're pretty cool guys. And we got to work together a lot. And then one of the guys was he's a fight fan. So we were like, we chatted. And then, yeah. So as we finished shooting, we were taking a Christmas break. I get a call from Matt Hugh. He told me that, hey, Paul, how you doing? So we're looking at you at maybe fighting in January. I was like, great. I'm shooting this TV show. So after this, I should be available. I'm training. So I just started training. So everything will be good. And then I get another call. He's like, hey, would you be up for come out and sign some autographs and then be an emergency backup? There's very little chance that you're going to fight. I was like, we'll pay your show fee. We'll pay you a certain amount of money just to come out. Okay. And I was like, cool. Sounds great to me. So then I just started training for about a week and a half, 2 weeks. I was just shooting a show and we had a break. So I was training.
2 weeks of training.
Yeah, like a week and a half. Okay. Just started training because I thought I was going to fight in January.
Okay.
So originally, there was a lot of misconceptions about whatever. Originally, I was supposed to fight in January. Like, there was a card in January in China that I was supposed to fight. Because there was a lot of talk about, oh, I had this whatever. But I started training because I thought I was going to fight in about 6 to 8 weeks.
Okay, so yeah, normal sort of
normal
prep time.
Situation.
Yeah.
And then they asked me to come out as an emergency backup. I just started training and there was, I'm just like, 5%? What the hell? Okay, I'll do it. Why not? What's the chances of that happening? Story of my life. So on that day, I finished shooting, and then I talked to my acting agent. I talked to my acting agent David, and then I was like, "Hey, I got to run out to this thing. I'm just supposed to be an emergency backup, so things are gonna be okay." And he's like, "Okay, just let me know if you actually have to fight." And I was like, "Okay." So I fly to Tokyo. I get off the plane. I was just funny story. I was like, I talked to my coach. I was like, there's no way I'm going to scrap, right? And then we're like, no, can't be. Can't be. And then I was like, okay. So I was like, okay. So I was like, you know, I've been good. I was on a diet. I was just like trying to, you know, get back in shape, running, you know, just getting back into the swing of things. Like literally just getting back in the swing of things. And then I had 10 missed phone calls. And then I was like, what's so important? So I was like, I guess the guy that was supposed to fight Brendan Vera didn't get on the airplane. I don't know what happened. That's not my problem.
Yeah.
I know everybody has all kinds of things to say, but I'm just like, at the end of the day, it was just, he didn't get on the plane and the show had to go on.
Yes.
There was 20,000 people that needed to watch this fight. And if he didn't fight,
somebody had to fight.
Somebody had to fight him. So, you know what? Sometimes life, it is what it is. So basically that was Tuesday. And I had to fight Brendan Vera on Friday. So a guy that I used to watch, I had to fight on 3 days' notice.
So what kind of mental state would you be in finding out that, okay,
I was disappointed I had to give my hamburger back. And then I was like, okay, this is going to be awesome. And then obviously you're like, what am I doing? You're doubting yourself. You're getting crazy stuff going on. And then just like thinking about remember my last fight, I didn't fight for a year. And the last time I fought, I stayed 3 days in the hospital because I had a crack orbital. This is all going through my head. And I'm just like,
championship fight, right?
And like, this is for the world heavy inaugural, the first, again, the first of many things I've done. The first inaugural 1FC heavyweight championship of the world. And I was like, sometimes I think to myself, man, Paul, you get yourself in a lot of trouble. This time, I don't know, man. I was like, so I didn't think anything of it until we actually got into Manila. Okay. And we got in, seen what the situation was actually like.
Yeah.
There was like 100, 300 foot posters of me hanging off the rafters of the mall and giant things. I was like, what is going on here? There was 3,000 people at the weigh-in.
Wow.
And then I'm like, this is the weigh-in. What's going to happen at the fight? So, yeah. So I got to the fight. I met Brendan Vera.
Yep.
And I told him, we were just like, we had to practice because we had to practice the face-off. They lifted us in a freaking, like a elevator thing. And it blew a bunch of fireworks. It was pretty funny. And then we were talking. I was just like, and this is not the Brendan Vera that I used to see. This guy was in shape. You know, sometimes when you look at a man in the eye, and then I know if I got you or not, that wasn't one of those days. So it was like, so obviously I'm panicking a little bit, slightly. And I was just like, man, this guy's ready to go. You know, I know when I'm ready to go. And then I was like, I saw that look in his eyes.
Yeah.
And he's half Filipino. This was his home crowd.
Yeah.
Again.
Big deal.
Big deal.
Yeah.
For the inaugural 1FC heavyweight championship of the world. The first one. And somebody had to do it.
So why not you?
Why not Paul Cheng? So I walked in there, you know, said a prayer and. You know what?
Honestly, any strategy? Like,
yeah, we were trying to land a left hook on him, like under left hook, but that didn't happen.
Yeah.
So, it was just more like, you know, usually I go forward, but then I made a mistake. I would start staying in front of him and trucking back inside, and you know, this is not me.
Any thought of taking him down or?
I didn't even think about it, to be honest, because I as soon as he hit me with that first leg kick, I tripped.
Yeah.
I was used to the one coming to the outside. He was in a left-handed stance. He smoked me on my inside leg. And I was like, oh my God, if I take a few more of these, I might collapse.
Yeah.
And I was just like, I have to do something now. I got to affect this guy somehow, some way now. You know, and take a chance, made a mistake, cost me. Heavyweight fight, that's hot. That's what happens. And then I was like, you know, I got stopped. You know, and I appreciate the opportunity. I appreciate everything. You know, the bosses even gave me my win bonus at the end. So it wasn't terrible. It wasn't a terrible day. You know, and sometimes I believe, you know, it was like, I think God saved me from myself that day. Because if it was, if I'm not a quitter, if I didn't get KO'd like that quickly, if I didn't get taken out like that quickly, I think I would have got a lot more damage.
Yeah, yeah, and it's not the bus driver elbowing you now.
No,
it's, yeah.
No, this is Brendan Vera.
Yeah.
This is a real deal dude. And then this is a dangerous guy. And then I was like, you know, I said, when I saw him the weigh-ins, when we looked in each other's eyes, I knew he was ready to go.
Yeah.
And then I knew, I didn't know, it is what it is, but you know, sometimes you just got to take your chance. You got to flip your coin, man.
You had said, though, that he was very appreciative of you standing in.
Yeah, he was a great guy. He was a great guy. You know, hey, I would be too. If you had no fight and then you were in your home crowd, the sold out arena, 20,000 people. Ever walked on a 20,000 seat arena watching just you? I have.
Yeah.
Even though it was only for 27 seconds. So, you know, and then that's another part of my sports journey. And then when I got back, I had to shoot 2 more episodes. And I had to call my agent, David. He was a little not happy with the situation. Because there was my less than 5% chance ended up me having a fight for a world title. And he was hoping nothing happened to me. So, yeah, I made it for shooting, thank God.
Should have bought some lottery tickets, too.
Yeah.
And the great thing is we're not done. So...
You've done
the acting stuff. Okay, you've done the fighting. Okay, and then we got two more big things here.
Two more things before we stop. I apologize for rambling on in your ears, guys, or people that's going to be watching or listening. But anyways, so I get off the airplane after that Brendan Vera fight. And then I get a call. I just got a call about inquiring about this Chinese Arena League.
Okay.
And then I was like, huh? It was like, hey, you're available, right? Because I retired from the competition. I actually retired after that day.
Sure.
But, okay. So I didn't fight. I haven't fought since. But, you know, you never... In life with this thing, you never know. But I'm just saying...
Never say never.
Never say never. But I'm just saying, like, it was like... I got off the plane, got a text. And then, hey, are you available for this football? And then I was like, hey, I'm not playing... I'm not fighting anymore, so we'll see. And I sent in this paper. Nothing happened. And I was just like, oh, this league is going to be crazy. Like, pro football in China? Are you nuts? I was the only Chinese football player in North America for a while. Then, like, and then I never thought about this. I filled it out, put it in. And then the league got put back a year. So I was like, okay, no, hey, nothing happened, so cool. And then I get a... Oh, my acting coach decides, he's like, hey, can I get some of your information? I was like, oh, for what? Sends it away, and all of a sudden I get a call from WWE. And I was like, what? So they flew this guy down, they flew their scout down, who used to be a CFL football player, Robert Gordon. He's like, actually my friend now. So we talk all the time, and then he's like, hey, WWE sent him down to check, to make sure I was in one piece. Because I was 38 years old, and then I did all this stuff.
Yeah.
And they brought me into one of their tryouts. So they hold this tryout every 3 or 4 months, and then all of a sudden I had deja vu of my youth. Going into the Hart House and meeting Stu Hart, I was like, oh, wow, this is crazy. This is actually happening. So I went down to WWE tryouts. They're really awesome.
Yeah.
Because, you know, like, I'm a stuntman and been in Hollywood and did all this stuff, you know? So it was kind of a natural.
Yep.
But, you know, again, my age, 38 years old. I didn't expect them to, you know, like, invest in me or anything like that. But, you know, I had a great performance. I believe I earned some respect. And then I even got, they offered me a little part-time position as a casual scout. I even got my first girl signed, Julia. Hey, congrats, Julia. Let's go, NXT.
But if you were 28,
if I was 28, hey, you know what? Just like I should have been teammate of Tom Brady. Hey, I might be in the NXT right now, you know, or I might be in WWE, or who knows. So again, don't ever give up on things. You know, sometimes people tell you no once, people tell you no twice, but never know. Because I just didn't know. I didn't know. I ended up finding a girl that they liked, and then she was basically like me, but 28 years old.
Yeah.
You know, so I was like, so you just never know what can happen. And I just... You know what? Anything you do, just roll with it. Roll with it. So, yeah, that was a great situation. So, and then there was, and then in June, after I came back from tryouts, there was some the CAFL draft. And I was like, I just started laughing because I was like, they didn't ask me to come work out, or they asked me to go to a tryout. They asked me to just go to some things. And then draft comes up. I didn't go to any of this. And so I was like, oh, it's okay. I sent them a resume like 2 years ago. And then with the first pick in the sixth round, the Beijing Lions select Paul Cheng. I was like, Paul Chi-Ping Cheng. I was like, my sister calls me just like, hey, bro, you got picked.
You got drafted.
Like, and then here's another little interesting background. The last time I got drafted, I was drafted in the first round with the sixth pick. And this time it kind of reversed around. So I wasn't anyone special. I was a sixth round pick. So I went in there and then I decided, I was like, hey, I waited till the last minute because I really wanted this WWE thing, NXT. It didn't work out, but we know a few of those, Saint Julia, and then the Bollywood boys, guys I train with, they're all there. I'm so happy for them. And then now, and then again, more people I met on my sports journey, all different sports. It's like crazy. And then I was, and then now I decided that I was going to the CAFL. At 38 years old, I'm going to play professional arena football in China. But again, I thought I was going to play against a bunch of Chinese. Again, not the case. So we go to camp. So we show up. There's a bunch of Asian guys, Chinese guys, and then we're like all Chinese, and it was pretty cool. I was like, I got to see some actual decent talent and then some big guys, some fast guys. And I was like, oh, this could work out okay. And also there's some guys that I was like, oh, I'm kind of worried about their safety.
Sure.
Then a week later, all the Americans came in. So my roommate, we had a Chinese player with an American roommate. So we're like blending of the cultures, but I'm kind of, you know, in between.
Yeah.
So, you know, not quite. And then they were kind of guys who were like, you're fake Chinese. You speak perfect English and blah, blah, blah. It was pretty funny. And my roommate or my roommate that ditched me later, Wayne. I'm kidding. I'm kidding, Wayne, if you watch this. So my roommate, Wayne Tribune. He was the starting starting guard for Rutgers University. And he went to training camp with the Dolphins. He was on the Denver Broncos practice roster.
Okay.
And I think the last team was with the San Francisco. He's like a big guard type guy. Really great guy. But I was just like, oh, I'm in trouble. Again, I was like, dude's like 6'4", 330 pounds. And just like, when he wanted to, he just did whatever he wanted to. And I was like, yeah. So, and our coach was Clint Dozell. So he's the head coach of Philadelphia Soul. So in the Arena Football League, and he's like a Arena League Hall of Famer quarterback. So it's all legitimate people.
Yeah.
And the guys I played with, hey, my defensive end, which I got him a WB trial after, his name is Louis Inzaghi, and he was like this, he's like a big giant defensive end from Wisconsin, played beside J.J. Watt. So I'm like, well, I got myself in some more trouble this time. So, but again, not really, because our team went 6-0. We won the championship. I went to win a championship first time in my life.
Wow.
That was really cool.
And when you played, it was all good. Like
I played like my youth.
Nice.
And I remember, Derek, we were actually running and all that stuff before. It got me ready again for a little bit. And then, yeah, I went there and I played like my youth. But here's the only problem. I still remember the last time I played. As soon as the game's over, and then I'm good to go. I'm like, we're good to go to the out or whatever. And then Monday, I'll be ready back to practice. Coach Dozell didn't see it that way for me, and my body didn't. It was like, I don't think I can move till about Wednesday. And then a coach was like, hey, you know what, Uncle Paul? That's what they call me, Uncle P. Paul. You can just practice, maybe show up on Wednesday. Just don't even bother until Wednesday. And then sometimes Thursday. And then this was a six-game season. So again, now I realize why 38-year-old guys shouldn't be playing professional football. But again, it's Paul Cheng. You just never know.
So you, so you've gone through all of this. Like, we've gone through the list here, all the different sports. And right now you're looking at, or you are doing some things that revolve around coaching.
Yes, totally. Yes. And right now I'm working at a UFC gym and I'm just kind of learning how to coach. And then I've been always, I've been working at my, I was coaching at Clinch MMA where I train. So it's been, you know, kind of, and again, I realize my age. So it's like time to start transitioning a little bit. So I'm kind of working on that. And then, you know, there might be, might be coaching opportunities for me in the CAFL. Okay. They've contacted me and there might be some coaching opportunities. But again, there might be playing opportunities still. But again, not sure. But, you know, hey, sometimes I always think, you know, hey, what's the wildest dreams that could possibly happen? What do you think about an MMA fight slash and then walk into a football arena football team, arena football season? That'd be kind of interesting, huh? But again, that's too crazy. But you never know.
Yeah. Well, and I think, I mean, you probably have this broad experience that nobody else has. And I mean, based on what we've talked about, you planning your future isn't really, you know, always working in your favor, but just,
oh, yeah,
you've just kind of just been spontaneously,
yeah, actually walking, like all of falling into stuff. And I just kind of went with it. And then things worked out for the better for the most part. So, you know, like I have to say, you know, money, you can't take it with you. And then I'm just like, you know, experiences, I believe I can. You know, I've lived many things, you know, just sometimes, you know, got to fight for a real world championship, got to be in some movies and some big movies and got to play in a stadium, 50,000 people on a Saturday night. You know, like, I'm just like, you know, I feel blessed, to be honest. And I got, you know, sometimes for a long time, I felt like I failed at a lot of things. But again, cumulatively, I don't believe I failed. You know, it just, you know, I think I achieved something, a different experience than any other athlete. You know, just, you know, and being an Asian athlete, it's quite rare to kind of come across a combo of different sports and be able to relatively succeed in North America.
Yeah. And from all of this, I mean, again, you've kind of passed some messages on to people, but what's the big message that you can, from your experience, that you can pass on to people and say, you know,
you know, I know a lot of guys, you know, once, you know, like I've went through this myself. Now, when you struggle, near the end of your sports career, or, you know, you all unexpectedly get cut and stuff like that, you know, don't quit on yourself. You know, you don't know what else can go on. And it's just that you might get a second chance doing completely something different. And, you know, you see there's lots of examples out there now, like football players turn into high-class MMA fighters or wrestlers turn into whatever, you know, there's... And then MMA fighters turning into wrestlers, professional wrestlers, and all kinds of things going on. So I'm just like, I just believe, you know, if you have a dream, go chase it.
Mm-hmm.
And then, you know, like, what's the worst ever? You reach for the moon? You reach for the stars? You hit the moon? Not so bad, right? So I just believe there's a second chance. You know, there's always a second chance. There's always another opportunity that arises. So just... You know, when you're in an opportunity, do the best you can. Don't sit there and be like, hey, oh, I don't know. This is just whatever. But you know what? You never know. I through all my life, an experience I had 10 years ago, all of a sudden came all full circle for me. You know, with the football. I was like, I never thought I'd ever play that game again.
Mm-hmm.
And all of a sudden, I had the best season and the most fun I've ever had in my life. And then also, you know, MMA. Everybody thought when I told everybody I'm going to be an MMA fighter and I'm going to fight like that. I'm going to fight in the big show. They're like, you're crazy. You're over 30 years old. And then all of a sudden it happened. I got to fight for a world title, even though on short notice, even though it wasn't good, but still got to do it.
And how many people can say they've done that, right?
Yeah. How many people can they say? And then, you know, I always strive myself. My parents wanted me, if I played a pro, they said, hey, they come watch if I played. I got to succeed. and they came to watch. Mm-hmm. I played professional,
yep.
even holding for seven games or seven regular season games. But, you know, I had a cup of coffee. You know, things happen. But don't think you failed. You know, it's about the cumulative experience. And guys, just keep working. Don't find yourself in that graveyard. You know, that's all I really have to say.
That's great. Well, I want to thank you for joining us. And I'll be posting like contact info for you, like on Twitter and stuff. So if people have any questions, they can follow up with you.
Yeah, for sure. Thanks, guys. Thanks, everybody, for listening. I really appreciate the opportunity. And I know I talked your ear off today. But again, well, another time. So, a little more stories. Take care. Have a good one.
Thanks, Paul. I hope you enjoyed our conversation with Paul Cheng. Never a dull moment when speaking to Paul. Always exciting, always fresh. If you have any comments or questions for Paul or ourselves, you can get us on Facebook at Strength Power Speed. That's Strength Power Speed with no vowels. Also on Twitter, same Strength Power Speed. And also on YouTube. Thank you for your time, and we look forward to talking to you again on strengthpowerspeed.com and our performance concepts chat.